Next, we're going to hear more about the climate side of things. So we have today We have Michael Anderson here. He's the state climatologist. He's with the Department of Water Resources. He's currently serving as state climatologist for California. He spent a lot of time working in the area of hydroclimate system modeling and monitoring. Mike, thank you for being here. We appreciate it.
Climatologist, yes. So that's NOAA has a state climate program when the federal agencies gave up on it. And so now I get to interact with NOAA. And you smile. There you go. Anyways, all right, so here we go. So we have the topic today of climate change and water supply research. Interesting elements. So here's the direction we'll take this one and run. Start with expectations. It's always good to frame that of where we think we're headed. But to have a good understanding of where we're headed, we need to know where we've been. So we need to take a look at history. I'm going to introduce a topic that hopefully you have some familiarity with called atmospheric rivers and talk a little bit about how they relate to the state's water supply. And then since this title did have the word research into it, we'll actually wind around, get around to actually what we're doing in the research arena right now, and take a look ahead at what happens next. All righty, so expectations in a single slide. So future climate in terms of water resources, increased air temperature, less snow, earlier runoff, precip continuing to fluctuate wildly, but more of it's going to fall as rain than snow. The ecosystem's going to respond the way it will. All of that's going to change the timing and amount of water in the rivers. Combine that with a little sea level rise, and you get a prescription for changing the way we operate our water resource systems. All righty, so you've seen this before. I like this. This comes from Mike Dettinger at Scripps, and this has probably been one of the most fantastic ways to point out, yes, California is different than the rest of the country. This is very helpful when you talk with your federal partners. Remember, the federal partners are back east in D.C. Look at their variability. One year looks like the next year looks like the next year. So you see federal programs set up that reflect that behavior, and sometimes they have a hard time interfacing in an area where one year can look absolutely nothing like the next, or as we found out this year, the year can start one direction, fake, and head the other direction in a hurry. John alluded to this, but here it is actually in colored dots for you. The number of days of precip that it takes to get half our annual precip, and this is looking at the last half of the 20th century. And you see out in the deserts area, you know, less than a week. Doesn't take long to get 2 inches of precip out there, but the rest of the state, we're still under 2 weeks. So that's a very short time window to accumulate precip that will turn into runoff and turn into water resources. So here we're going to do a lot of fun with data, and we'll start with the Northern Sierra 8 Station Index. So this is an index developed at the department. And you see the little triangles representing the precip stations that the index comes from. Has an annual average of 50 inches, so a nice number, work in your head. But I'm mentioning that variability. The biggest year, 88.5 inches versus 1924, 17.1. We have months that exceed what they had in 1924. Period of record goes back to 1921, and if you're really interested, the 8 stations are listed there for you, running from the American River watershed up to the watershed above Shasta Reservoir. Monthly distribution breaks down this way. You'll see that December, January, and February make up over half the annual total, and this is where those magic 2 weeks usually happen. Biggest month 30 inches in 1955, produced a very large flood that actually is the foundation for most of the Central Valley flood management system. Minimum month, 45 times, where we have yet to find a drop of rain. Expected in the summertime, but it has happened in December. That gets to be a problem. Alrighty, so here's how we look at change. So period of records in blue, the last 30 years of the 20th century is in red. And we see that January, February, and March, we see increases. December, a little bit of a decrease. Throw in what's happened since the 21st century, and again, Mother Nature's taken a left turn here. Now we're focusing most of our precip into December. January and February really have been kind of dry months. Now again, December, January, and February are supposed to be our big three. See a little rebound in March, but you can see where this can challenge trying to operate a system when you have rules that only tell you when you can do what with water. And then we turn it into runoff, again looking at the full period of record, latter 30 years where we started seeing increases in January through March, decreases in April through July. 21st century, we're seeing kind of a different pattern from that. And so what we're starting to see is that it's not just a monotonic march towards a future that's going to be different than today, but we can fluctuate quite a bit along the way. And here's a picture of it. A lot of wiggly lines through time for a lot of different places. So at the bottom there, we have Los Angeles County. And you can see structures there that are reflected in the wetter regions of the north, Sonoma and Mendocino counties on the coast. And then the Northern Sierra 8 Station Index, what we talked about earlier. The 5 Station Index is for the San Joaquin Basin. But you see the large fluctuations, and in some cases, this is a decadal scale variability of 10 to 15 inches up in the north. That's a pretty sizable fluctuation. I can tell you it fluctuates, but I can't tell you why. And that goes a long way towards being able to predict what's going to happen next. So some of the things we're looking at is something called the Pacific Decadal Oscillation. It's an ocean temperature structure. It has a warm phase and a cold phase. Warm phase tends to have tropics that looks more like El Nino. A cold phase or negative phase tends to have a tropics that looks more like La Nina. We're currently in a negative phase, and as you see in a negative phase, December precip historically tends to be accentuated. So we have that happening on top of climate changing as well, just to make it easy. So again, just a few storms are at the core of California's water supplies. Well, what do these storms look like? Not quite Jerry Garcia art, but we can flip through and we see ENSO waves within the tropics. Another process called the Madden-Julian Oscillation, which is a very large scale organized convection that propagates across the tropics. With storm tracks and storm formation in the eastern Pacific, and these fun-loving things called atmospheric rivers. Concentrated moisture happening in the first 5,000 feet of the atmosphere goes roaring across the ocean and runs into California. What do you suppose it runs into? Got some hills that kind of get in the way and are actually very effective in making that water fall out of the sky. But again, it depends on the dynamics of that winter storm system that are driving it. If it's a warm system, that's a lot of rain that can happen. If it happens for a long enough duration, you get flooding. If it's a colder storm, these can be absolutely fantastic for water supply. Entertainingly enough, we saw one of each this year. Well, a little bit of everything. Anyway, for things to work in California, we actually have to rely on the alignment of several processes happening across the Pacific, operating at multiple space and time scales. So all of this is going on, and all of this is very important to climate change. It's really hard to tease this out of what you're collecting in a bucket on a hillside. in terms of precip. There's a lot more going on. And that gets to some of the work that we've been doing. So here we'll take a little more look at the structure of these storms and how they come together. So here is a storm in 2008. Center of the storm systems up there by Washington and British Columbia. You see a lot of pretty colors there down over California, just south of Half Moon Bay. Had about a foot of rain as all that low-level moisture runs into the mountains. Gets into bigger mountains, and it's a cold enough storm that we got 6 to 10 feet of snow. This is in 2 days. Pretty good winds that drive that moisture up against the mountains, big enough to make the ocean start setting up to 32 feet in height. So, you know, that's some pretty good winds blowing. But all of that's happening more than 500 miles away from the center of that low. So this is something that doesn't look anything like what the East Coast is used to dealing with when they deal with their major storms. Their major storms, hurricanes. Everything's wrapped up in a nice little package that rolls. And out here, we just have things that are looking kind of differently. So we have a lot of impacts that are associated with the landfalls of these atmospheric river elements. Yet operationally, we're still just now learning how to take a look at these. Like I said, there's more to it than just catching the water that falls out of the sky. So here's what we're doing. So NOAA Surf Systems Research Lab has a program called the Hydrometeorological Test Bed. And since it's a mouthful, we abbreviate it HMT. That's a lot easier to say. So HMT spent almost a decade out here in California working on looking at how you observe atmospheric rivers. The department was fortunate enough to be able to observe and follow along, and we looked at it and we said there's some good stuff here to invest in. So we have four spots hopefully here within the next year. We have one that's operational right now at Bodega Bay. These are atmospheric river observatories, and what we have here is a wind profiler, and combine that with GPS MET, which tells us how much water vapor is above land. And we'll go back a few slides here. Notice that. Notice over land, everything's dark. Satellite imagery, we can find out how much water vapor there is as long as the lower boundary's water. Yet really understanding what's going on once it gets to shore, and the Sierras aren't quite oceanfront property yet, so we want to be able to see what that is. So all the pink dots there will actually provide us that information over land. And this past year, this has gone operational, and we'll see some examples of this. On the coast, we combine that with a wind profiler. That gives us how much water vapor flux is coming ashore. That tells us how big that fire hose is of moisture coming ashore. The little blue squares along right at the edge of the mountains, and on that lee side there, those are vertically pointing radar that tells us when that rain turns to snow. How warm is that event? That's really important to determining water supply building or flood management. All the other little dots on there are soil moisture. Because we take a good 3 months off from precip, the soils dry out, it takes a while for the watershed to wet up before it actually starts producing runoff. And if you go through a dry year, it takes even longer. So we're actually trying to track that rather than wait until the river responds and say, okay, the watershed's wet now, which is what we have done historically. Alrighty, so some real-time observations back in November, at the end of November, and this is really fun because this is right before the American Geophysical Union's fall meeting in San Francisco, and we were doing a little press conference to announce this network. And lo and behold, Mother Nature was kind enough to give us an event to demonstrate. Anyways, what you see here is on November 28th, and these are the snow level radar. And so we see up north here, for those of you that have really, really, really good eyes, that's a little less than 6,000 feet. Get down here by the coast, that's over 9,000 feet. So there's quite a slope there going on. The rain coming in, now we can look and see this is the moisture that we were talking about. And these are in centimeters. We can see these areas are really dry, and we see the moisture coming ashore and going north, and the purple ones are over an inch of moisture. So if you can imagine an inch of moisture over huge areas getting squeezed out into the watersheds, you can appreciate the amount of water then that can fall. And you see in the red areas, that's where it got over 3 centimeters. That means if you took that, so that sensor's looking up, and if you took all the water vapor that's above that sensor, squeeze it out, that's how much is over that. But you take that inch and you multiply it by the miles, and then you realize all that's being driven up against a mountain range in a much smaller space. You're converging that water and creating a very effective way to create precipitation and runoff. And here we can actually see that. That storm, which call an ARE, atmospheric river event, first one. 15.5 inches fell on the 8-station index in 8 days. Lo and behold, that turned out to be a third of the year's total. So 8 days, there it was. There was your big precip event. And as John said, that provided a good boost to runoff into the reservoirs that proved to be really, really, really helpful and keep things from being interesting. Then, follow on just a couple weeks later, we get the second blast here. A little smaller jump, but we get, this is a colder storm, 6-inch increase in snow water equivalent. That proved, and that happened in 5 days, that proved to be almost a third of the Northern Sierra snowpack in that one event. So these events are big pulses that come to us. So if you think about that, and then you think about the way climate change is done, where we look at averages and how averages change slowly over time, when we deal with water supply flood management here, we're dealing with event processes that rely on physics that span across the entire Pacific. So for California, we've got a little more to work on than just trying to follow a trend. So one way, again, because we don't name our storms, we don't have a scale to say how big they are. Mike Denger and our next speaker, Marty Ralph, started working on it and looked at taking 3-day totals of precipitation and categorizing them by the size, just to kind of see, well, how do these storms rate compared to the rest of the country? And you can see that California's big events here rival the Gulf Coast hurricane belt quite well. So just as big, but you can imagine we rely on them. Those are atmospheric river events. So what do we do? Well, we're trying to make advancements in monitoring these conditions and being able then to start documenting their change. Great, we found out about them, but now we need to start documenting that so we can start following along and looking how a warmer atmosphere that might hold more water, how that might relate in terms of its sudden delivery to California. Again, you have a huge ocean, and then you get to California where we have high elevations, and when you have an extreme event, it's really hard on a sensor to actually sit there and not blow away. So we look at remote sensing as opportunities to try and get more information on this. To be able to talk about change, you have to have a climatology or characteristics. And so looking at characteristics of past, present, and future atmospheric rivers and how that might relate into water resources in California. And as I mentioned, this isn't a monotonic process. We have to map that onto a background of decadal variability to understand how those decadal scale fluctuations that are on the order of 20% by themselves map on, and if we can understand that better, that might get us to Janine's desire to actually know what's happening next. At least we can say it's a good direction to head. There's a lot of work to do. So how do we do it? Well, we start with targeted opportunities and monitoring. We work closely with our federal partners, as Janine mentioned, with NASA. NASA gets some money and says, let's see what we can do. We've got a good partner now. We can look and see how we can take advantage of the work they're doing to benefit California. We need to develop tools and indicators that track change and facilitate planning efforts. make sure that you take the data, you can actually turn it into something that's usable. I can tell you, you have 3 inches of water over your head. So what? There you go. Understanding that, understanding the variability across time scales. Understanding what happens when you start with a really wet fall that suddenly left turns and then goes completely dry. Understanding how that can happen year to year, decade to decade, and how that might change as we warm the planet. And then you get all that, figure out how everything works together so that you can actually execute that in your water management plans in a changing climate. So we'll stop there.
Hi. You mentioned about the remote sensing part. How are the GPS reflectometry and Global Hawk-based measurements integrated in this laboratory which you are talking about?
So the GPS MET sensors are part of the plate boundary observatory. So in California, since our land surface doesn't stay put, it likes to move as well, and we've got a lot of sensors in place to keep track of that. Turns out you can add some meteorological instrumentation to it, and you can improve their signal. At the same time, you find out how much water vapor is in the atmosphere, and so it's a good leverage there. We haven't explored fully the Global Hawk applications. That's been more of a research mode for NOAA, in part because it costs quite a bit of money, and that we looked at the price tag on that one, and we said that's a little outside our budget. But it is interesting, and like I said, that's when you find a partner to leverage, and you look if they're already doing something, and you say, oh, by the way, can you?
Thank you.
Yeah. I'm just curious, with this new technology and analysis tools, have you found, what type of correlation have you found to exist between this new findings and methods compared to some of the older ways that we've done things in our storm and hydrologic runoff analyses of past centuries, or decades, I should say?
As far as getting far enough to actually compare them, we're still trying to develop the tools to translate the new information into that something that you can compare with their traditional tools of precip and runoff, and how you might integrate them into the process. That's no small feat, particularly the way we've developed some of the tools of the past, where you need a fairly lengthy set of data to work with to understand it and employ it in the models. And so take, for example, soil moisture monitoring. When talking with the modelers, they say, well, come back to us when you got a couple decades worth of data and we can see how it works. We've got a few years to go before we get to that point, but we're hoping to learn as we go and not just kind of check back in later as it was suggested to us. That's all right. He can answer his question.
Yeah, Mike, if I could add to that a little bit. That's a very good question. One possibility I'll show in a moment in the next presentation, we'll cover some of the soil moisture and AR characteristics carefully. But I think at this stage in the game, like Mike says, we're early in the process, and quantitative statistics are hard to come by until we've gotten a bit of more experience under the belt. Anecdotes, however, are another matter. And we had an example of an atmospheric river observatory measurement system in place in Washington State a couple of years ago, and there was a major damage to a reservoir, a flood control reservoir outside Seattle. And the Corps of Engineers declared it unsafe, and the operators were concerned about the storms coming in that winter. So they took advantage of our new observations, and in fact, the Corps of Engineers, thankfully that dam didn't get, that reservoir or lake didn't get hit that bad, but a storm hit a nearby one. And they used the new observations to make an operational decision about not taking over operation of that reservoir for flood control from the local water supply operators. And that decision, in hindsight, was a very good decision, And that's been used in their thinking strategically for the future, and we're working on some studies to build on that using the network that's going in place permanently in California as a place to demonstrate it.
Michael, with all the studies that are doing, you know, global warming, the how many degrees, 1 degree, half a degree, 2 degrees, how about the psychometry of the air, the amount of water that'll be retained, and the pressures, because the barometric pressure along with the water, and then of course the mountains, it all plays in what turns out to be snow versus water, and what goes over the mountain and lands in the desert. I'm wondering if that's being looked at.
That's exactly what I was talking about when we're trying to characterize future atmospheric rivers. Again, it's not as simple as saying, excuse me, more water in the air, more water's going to fall. You have the blending of a moisture plume, atmospheric dynamics, and the topography that all come together in some really nuanced ways. And we're actually trying to tease that out systematically with some projects that we have going on. And hopefully in the next year or two, we'll actually start to see some of that information come out.
Okay. Mike, thank you very much.